Good morning. Hi, Bettendorf Middle Schoolers. I'm back again to do another virtual book talk with another book from our MacInVia ebook database. Believe it or not, this is my third try at this. My microphone has not been working very well, so hopefully it works this time. So I'm going to get into present mode and we will get started. Okay, today is Monday, May 4th. This is our sixth book talk. Hopefully you've had a chance to look at some of the other ones. And I apologize that this, I missed Friday. I had some things I had to attend to, so I just pushed ahead to today. So this was actually the one I intended to do Friday, but some things got in the way of my doing that. The book I've selected to share with you today is another realistic fiction selection. This is The Seventh Most Important Thing by Shelley Pearsall. The main character is 13-year-old Arthur T. Owens. He has recently suffered a tragedy. His father was killed in a motorcycle accident, and there are rumors circulating that the circumstances of the accident are suspicious. Arthur is not dealing with his father's grief or his passing very well. Arthur is sad and he's also very angry. So he's trying to move through the grief process, but he's not having a very good time with it. The setting of the story is actually the early 1960s. So there will be some references made to some important events that happened during that time. Arthur, again, angry, sees the local man known as the junk man. The junk man goes around town picking up different items from people's trash, and he's just known about town as the junk man. He notices that he is wearing something that he believes once belonged to his father, to Owen's father, sorry, Arthur's father. So he picks up a brick with the intention of hitting the junk man in the head with it. But it's a little windy that day, and the brick hits the junk man in the arm and does injure him just a little bit. Anyway, but this is observed by somebody in town, and Arthur gets sent to juvenile detention for 3 weeks. Well, 3 weeks are over, and it's time for him to go to a hearing to find out what his sentence will be, if he'll be staying in juvenile detention longer or what's going to happen to him. And at the hearing, the junk man is present, and he speaks up, and instead of seeing Arthur go back to juvenile detention, the junk man suggests that he spend 120 hours doing community service with him. The judge is agreeable to this, and so Arthur begins his community service with the junk man. The junk man gives him a rickety grocery cart and directs him with a list to collect 7 different items through looking through trash. Those 7 items that Arthur is collecting are glass bottles, tinfoil, cardboard, pieces of wood, light bulbs, coffee cans, and mirrors. Now, the list might seem strange to you and to Arthur, but what he discovers is the junk man uses those things to create beauty. It's not just about the junk, it's about what can be done with it and add something back. And so it's a story of relationships and finding the good in people and working through the grieving process. I'm actually going to read the second chapter to you. And as I'm reading, the video that you're watching is other people's collection of trash and turning it into artwork. So enjoy the video and the excerpt. This is chapter 2. A lot happened during the 3 weeks Arthur was locked up, the worst being that President Kennedy was killed. Then the guy who killed President Kennedy was killed. And then the Thanksgiving holiday passed without much mention in juvie or anywhere else. Arthur didn't mind missing it. Along with the rest of the world, he didn't have much to be thankful for. 4 days after Thanksgiving, Arthur was brought to the courthouse for the hearing that would decide his fate. He was seated in a long row of bad kids, so he figured it was going to be a while. A Unfortunately, the judge assigned to hear Arthur Owen's case was not a listening sort of man. Judge Philip Warner liked his billowy black robe and the sound of his own voice too much. He reminded Arthur of those big horseflies that get stuck in your window in the summertime and buzz like mad and won't quit no matter what you do. As the morning dragged on, the temperature in the courtroom rose. If Arthur had ever wondered what the fires of hell were like, Judge Warner's courtroom was giving him a pretty good idea. People who had come in wearing their winter coats and wool suit jackets were down to their shirt sleeves. Arthur kept his suit jacket neatly buttoned and his sleeves down. He knew it was what his mom would want. Doing his best to stay awake, he tried to focus on the walls of the courtroom, which were covered with vertical panels of grooved wood. Arthur thought maybe the design was supposed to make the room appear sleek and modern, but the longer he stared at the panels, the more they seemed to ripple in sickening waves. He began to believe that even the walls had been designed as a kind of punishment. The combination of all these things, the swimming walls, the heat, the sweat, and the judge's endless voice, made him feel as if he just might puke when his turn finally came. "Arthur T. Owens, approach the bench," the bailiff called out. It was only a few steps from his chair to the judge's bench, but to Arthur, it felt like miles. He could sense the breathing, sweaty mass of people behind him the way you sense the weight of bullies right before they're about to smash you into a wall of lockers at school. There had been a lot of bullies in juvie. It was practically a bully vacation spot. No doubt some of the people in the courtroom were surprised to see what Arthur Owens looked like as he walked to the front. He wasn't your typical juvie thug. He didn't have meat slabs for hands or full facial hair or an insolent grin. He thought he could hear a few whispers behind him. "That's him?" Arthur Owens was slender, pale, and moody looking. Maybe he was a little taller than some 13-year-olds. His father had been tall. But mostly he was someone who wouldn't get noticed walking down the street. When his brown hair flopped over his eyes, Arthur had the bad habit of leaving it there, which drove his mother crazy. He also didn't smile much. As Arthur glanced nervously at the long row of juvenile delinquents, he could tell he was one of the youngest of all the young criminals waiting on the judge that day. And from what he could see, he was the only person who was wearing an almost new funeral suit that didn't fit him very well. And that is chapter 2. If you're interested in reading, just a reminder, the book talks that I'm doing are located on the Symbaloo, where the red arrow is. That is where you can find all of the book talks that I've done. And the login to Mac and Via is on the left. You can use your 6-digit username and your 6-digit password without the BCS. From the Mac and Via landing page, click groups on the left, and the first list that comes up are the, we'll call it our COVID-19 virtual book talks. Also, if you're not aware, there is an app for both iOS and Android that works very well with our Mac and Via database. And to set it up, you just need your 6-digit username and your 6-digit password without the BCS. So I hope you get a chance to take a look at the book talks and do a little reading this week. I hope everybody is doing well. And if you need help with anything, please don't be afraid to reach out to staff. I will see you on Wednesday.